Hey, how's it going, everyone? I'm David Saylor, an electrical engineer major at FAMU. I'm also the researcher in this project, and today we're going to be going over spring and displacement.
Hey, what's up? I'm Marquise Hargrave, first year industrial engineer student, and I'm the writer.
I am Corey Ritchie, a second year civil engineering student, and I'm the producer.
You guys may experience some noise in this video, but it's because we're in the library and it's finals week and y'all know how I can get. But also, I'm gonna go into explaining how calculus relates to electrical engineering. Calculus relates to electrical engineering because it is a fundamental tool in expressing the relationships between structures and objects in a system.
Calculus relates to civil engineering by deriving basic fluid mechanic equations. For example, storm drains, open channel systems uses calculus methods to determine results.
The problem we're about to do relates specifically with engineering because we're dealing with springs, and springs are fundamental components of engineering. Knowing the displacement and velocity of springs are very important when dealing with most, if not all, mechanical systems.
So you guys, we're engineers, and one of the perfect examples in the engineering world is springs and spring displacements. Most mechanical systems use springs to get the jobs done that they're doing. So this problem right here, we took this problem out of the book. It's dealing with spring displacement, and I'm just gonna go ahead and just reiterate the question. It's saying the weight is attached to a spring and reaches its equilibrium position at x equals zero. It is then set in motion, resulting in the displacement of x equals cosine t. This is the initial position that the displacement is, that the spring is in. This is where it displaces initially after the first initial force is added to it. Then it's saying x is measured in centimeters and t is measured in seconds. So right here we got a small diagram of how this problem would be set up in the real world. We got the springs and we got the weights added to it. Now, as I explained earlier, this is the initial spring right here, but when you add the initial force, it comes down right here. Now, every instant after that, we have to find the spring displacement at the times below. Now they want to know what's the spring displacement at t equals 0, t equals power of 3, t equals 3 power of 4. Alright, so what we did, we took the times t and we plugged it in the initial equation. The initial equation was 10 cosine t, so we plugged in t equals 0 for 10 cosine t. That's when we got 10 centimeters. Now we're going to find the displacement at the time t equals power of 3. Therefore, we'll plug in power of 3 into the initial equation. That's when we get 10 cosine of power of 3. That equals out to 5 centimeters. Now we're going to go ahead and do t equals 3 power of 4. So at the time, it'll be 3 power of 4. We'll plug 3 power of 4 into 10 cosine. Well, 10 cosine 3 power of 4. That's when we'll end up getting 5 square root 2 centimeters. But we're approximating it out to be 7.07 centimeters.
For the second part of our problem, we were asked to find the spring's velocity at the given points. We have to remember that in order to find the velocity, we have to find the first derivative of the initial position. In order to do that, to find the derivative, we got v of t is equal to negative 10 sine of t. Once we found that, we substituted each value of t for the given values that we were given. For the first one, we got t equals 0, so we substituted that into negative 10 sine of 0, and that came out to 0 centimeters of seconds, because that's what we were asked to find in the equation. Once we got pi over 3, we got negative 10 sine of pi over 3, which equal to negative 5 square root of 3, or negative 8.66 centimeters squared, or 10 seconds. For the third one, we got t equals to 3 pi over 4, which is equal to negative 10 sine of 3 pi over 4, and that equals to negative 5 square root of 2, or negative 7.07 centimeters to seconds. The reason why a lot of our problems are negative is because we're dealing with a free-falling object. And when things are free-falling, they're moving in a negative direction, which results in a negative velocity.
In conclusion, calculus and engineering is essential because the majority of the formulas used in engineering are used to derive in calculus. Calculus is the base form of math you would use in engineering to be successful in the engineering world.
For example, as an industrial engineer, we would use velocity to speed up another company's production and also use maximin to help a company get the maximum profit and minimum
And as an electrical engineer, we use calculus to describe relationships between circuits and other aspects of the systems that involve circuits. Damn, I said circuits.
Thank you.